Hello, everyone. My name is Chad Wilson. I'm the president of Emory Law School's chapter of the National Lawyers Guild, and we're very pleased today to have Professor Harold J. Berman speak about why he opposes the apparently imminent war against Iraq that is going to be leveled against Iraq by the Bush administration. I could speak for 45 minutes about Harold J. Berman's accomplishments. What I'd rather do is say that I've been here almost three and a half years, and he has provided me with wise counsel in many areas. He's done so for many of your faculty and for many practitioners here in the United States and abroad, and many law students. So when the question of the war came to us as the National Lawyers Guild, I went to him seeking wise counsel. And his counsel was something that I've heard time and time again from him, that the essence of law and justice has to do with having a hearing. It's a sentiment that I think is very shared by many great people throughout history, Martin Luther King Jr. in particular. And I'd like to introduce Professor Berman and our speaker series that we hope will continue about the war with a short quote from Martin Luther King Jr. It's a quote that he said in April 4th, 1967, when the Vietnam War was in full fury. He said, "A time comes when silence is betrayal. Some of us who have already begun to break the silence of the night have found that the calling to speak is often a vocation of agony. But we must speak. We must speak with all the humility that is appropriate to our limited vision. But most of all, we must speak." Thank you for coming to listen to Professor Berman speak. He's willing to speak first, and then hopefully everyone else will join in a discussion that can continue throughout the law school about the war. Thank you.
Thank you, Chad Wilson. Thank you. And thank the Emory Lawyers Guild, Student Lawyers Guild, for inviting me. I hope will be the first of a series of sessions on war and peace, having in mind the open threat by the president to launch a war against Iraq. And also, I'm honored by the designation in the notices that were put up, awarded to me as an expert in world law. It advertises the very ambitious title of the course that I gave for the first time 2 years ago and last year, and will give again this coming spring, in which, by the way, other members of the faculty also conduct some of the classes. And secondly, it makes me out to be an expert in a subject in which, unfortunately, there are no experts as yet. But let me just say what I mean by world law, because it's highly relevant to the matters we're here to discuss. By world law, I mean the common features of the world's major legal systems, especially those common features that are emerging as the peoples of the world come increasingly into contact with each other. We have a world economy, and with it goes a great deal of world economic law. Bankers' letter of credit, my favorite examples are the letter of credit, which is the same all over the world, Moscow, Buenos Aires, Timbuktu, it doesn't matter, New York, wherever you are, a banker's letter. The bankers are in contact with each other, debiting and crediting each other's accounts. A bill of lading, that's my second favorite example, if it's made out properly, is a negotiable document of title everywhere in the world. Export and import transactions are conducted on the basis of a body of what is clearly world law. And connected with the world economy is world technology, world health, world environment, human rights, world sports. There's an arbitration court of sport in Geneva, which all the Olympic athletes are bound to submit any complaints to or disputes, have to settle disputes. World trade, world tourism, each one of these has an emerging body of transnational legal principles and procedures that are developing along with it. And with the coming together of virtually all the peoples of the world in a host of different contexts, there's developing what I think could be called a common law of mankind, which, by the way, is being practiced today in the law firms of the United States far more widely than it's being studied in the American law schools. Well, I'll come back to that, but first let me start with public international law, namely legal relationships among nation states, on which I'm also not an expert. We do have experts on that, however, and I will speak only tentatively of giving you my ideas of the relationship of what's happening with regard to Iraq and public international law. There are three basic questions, I think, that we need to answer, and I'll state each question, and then I'll give very briefly my own answer in anticipation of questions, in anticipation of your discussion. The first question, does Saddam Hussein's Iraq pose a grave and immediate threat to the United States and to its allies? Under international law, as I understand it, the threat has to be both grave and immediate to justify what is called a preemptive strike. The CIA itself has reported to Congress that Iraq has not acquired chemical, biological, or nuclear weapons. Whether or not Iraq is devoting resources in order to acquire such weapons at some time in the future is to be answered by the United Nations inspectors. Iraq has said that it is not seeking to acquire such weapons. It has promised to give to the UN inspectors full opportunity to conduct unfettered examination of all its premises and all its activities to verify that fact. President Bush would also link Iraq with terrorism, against which, whatever it is, he has already declared war, but there is hardly any evidence of any link, and virtually no observer believes it exists, between Iraq and terrorism. Indeed, I think it's of the very nature of terrorism, as I understand it, that it is stateless. Terrorists are not states. If states exercise what we would call terror, that's an act of war. But if individuals commit this crime of terrorism, they do it without the burden of a state which could be retaliated against. The second question, if it appears after full inspection that Iraq is indeed in the process of acquiring weapons of mass destruction, would an attack by one or more nations acting independently of the United Nations be justified legally? And here I would really defer to experts in public international law, experts in United Nations law, experts also in the agreement which was reached at the end of the Gulf War concerning Iraq's obligations. I don't have that expertise. I know what I read in the papers. I think I'm safe, however, in asserting the following, that Iraq is in a different position legally from the existing nuclear powers, Russia, India, China, Pakistan, Israel, possibly now North Korea. Those, as far as I know, are the existing nuclear powers. Iraq, I think, is in a different situation. Iraq launched a war against Kuwait, and the United Nations authorized intervention by the United States, Britain, and other nations to invade Iraq. I've read that 30 nations supported that invasion. I'm not sure exactly what that means. I've read actually that 30 nations were involved in the invasion. At any rate, it was a United Nations operation. And a defeated Iraq agreed not only to forswear the acquisition of biological, chemical, and nuclear weapons, but also to permit United Nations inspectors to have full access to Iraq in order to enforce that obligation. And these were obligations of Iraq to the United Nations, obligations which Iraq then violated in 1998 by expelling the UN inspectors. And I would suppose that enforcement of those obligations is within the sole legal competence of the United Nations. If I understand correctly, Iraq, after the invasion of Kuwait, was defeated by a coalition of military forces And one of the terms of its surrender was that it would eliminate all nuclear, biological, chemical weapons of mass destruction in its possession, and that it would cease to attempt to produce or acquire such weapons in the future, and that it would accept UN inspectors to enforce those commitments. And as you know, these inspections took place from 1992 to 1998, and the inspectors at the time reported that Iraq was in compliance with the terms of its commitment. But Iraq then expelled the inspectors and would not allow them to return, and now faced with enormous pressure from the international community, especially the United States, Iraq has agreed to let the inspectors return, has pledged that they will be given complete and unfettered freedom to carry out any inspections they wish. Now, I also understand that Saddam Hussein is a tyrant who has brutalized his own population, is prepared to do anything to maintain his own power. He's used biological weapons, I've read, to slaughter thousands of his own citizens, the Kurds in the north, if that's the correct story. He's believed to have plotted the assassination of President Bush's father, the first President Bush. I can't help but think that that weighs very heavily on the mind of the present President Bush, who has said, however, I've been told, I didn't hear him say this, but I was told by a reliable source that he said, was it on television or in the press, to the press or elsewhere, and I understand this is more or less a direct quote, that his policy is not related to the fact that Hussein attempted to assassinate, as he put it, my daddy. I think he should have said my father, but at any rate. It's evident that Saddam, I'm quite prepared to believe, would do anything to enhance his power. And I understand, therefore, the necessity for forcing him to allow inspections and to abandon any attempt to produce offensive weapons. And I'm prepared to believe that it may be legally justified for the United Nations to authorize a military invasion of Iraq if Saddam Hussein insists on, as a result of the inspections, it's now determined that Saddam does not comply and is about to produce nuclear or biological or chemical weapons of mass destruction in violation of the obligations which it incurred at the end of the Gulf War to the United Nations. What I don't believe is that it would be legally justified for the United States to act unilaterally in this matter, or for that matter bilaterally with another nation, Great Britain or whoever, or indeed, I don't believe it would be legally justified for the United Nations to authorize military actions without first having exhausted all diplomatic efforts. Now, those are two different responses to the question of what should be done after, if the inspectors determine that Saddam is violating his obligations to eliminate any effort, any weapons of mass destruction. Now, the third question I have is, what would be the effect of a military attack against Iraq if the United Nations inspectors determine that Iraq is not in violation of its obligations with respect to weapons? And let me say first, I'm not talking about what it would take to conduct such a war or about the political or economic consequences of such a war. This is a topic which I'm not, maybe discussed if you wish, but I think here, especially in the law school, it's important to talk about the legal aspects of this matter. I might say parenthetically that I believe the cost would be overwhelming, that the political and economic consequences would be disastrous, but I'm only talking now about the legal effect. That is the effect of such a war on the effort to create a world order based on law. And here's where world law comes in. In the 20th and 21st centuries, for the first time in the history of the human race, all the peoples of the entire world are in immediate contact with each other. It's an extraordinary fact to have lived through that the entire world is now, everybody's in touch. An explosion of a chemical plant in Bhopal, India, and there were lawsuits all over the world. For the first time in human history, what happens anywhere in the world can have an immediate effect on what happens elsewhere in the world, everywhere else. And little by little, mankind is developing legal processes and legal standards for solving transnational problems, for resolving transnational conflicts. And unfortunately, we have a president who has had no previous education in world affairs. During the campaign for election, he was on Jim Lehrer's PBS television show, and he said, I'm not going to play like I've been a person who spent hours involved with foreign policy. I am who I am. Well, he's now learning on the job from advisors like Cheney and Rumsfeld and Rice and Wolfowitz, people whose vision of the future seems to be world domination by the United States. As far as I can tell from the newspapers, they have only a negative response to the idea of a world governed by law. They seem not to realize that in the long run, the United States constitutes only a very small part of the New World Order that technology, if you like, has midwifed. The United States has 300 million people in a world of over 6 billion. We are one nation in a world of about 190 nations. We're one nuclear power now in a world of now 6, and with North Korea, possibly 7 nuclear powers. And so it seems to me that we'd better stop talking superpower and start talking partner. We'd better stop thinking military force and economic sanctions and start thinking international diplomacy and world law. And that is my very brief response to the invitation which was given to me to speak on this subject, and I would like very much to hear comments and questions, but above all, your own views of the matter. Maybe the best thing for me would be to stay up here and take responses, if that's all right.
Anyone has a question, if you would step to the mic. This is being recorded. There are several faculty members and students who couldn't make it for other reasons. Wanted us to have it recorded so that they can view it. But very informal, just start a queue and whoever's first will ask the question.
Well, since there are no questions, I was going to leave, but I've done this in class once. No questions, I leave.
I was just wondering, how do you think it will play out if the United States continues to make exceptions to conventions and multilateral treaties and continues to act without the United Nations? Do you think it will ultimately end in U.S. domination, or will there be the exact reverse of that?
I don't see how. I would think the reverse. I don't see how the United States could enforce its will throughout the world unless it had cooperation from others. Now, economically, if there's a collapse of currencies in Japan and so forth, it hits us as well. What happens elsewhere affects us vitally. We are all over the world. I read that we have $4 trillion of foreign investment in the United States, and $4 trillion of American investment abroad. Trillion, I think, isn't it something like a lot of billion, 1,000 billion, is that right? And a billion is 1,000 million, if I learned it correctly at my childhood. If it's still true, though, nowadays you have to take out a machine to verify all these numerical facts. I don't see, I mean, the economics is clear, you see, and now, but behind the economics are people and countries and policies and law, and we somehow economics grasps us. But the same thing is true with disease. I mean, we're now facing world disease. I think we have to ultimately do with nuclear weapons perhaps what we've done with smallpox, except maybe that if a few countries keep the small vials of the virus there, we're just as bad a situation as we were almost to start with. But I just don't see how, and I don't think anybody seriously believes that the United States could dominate a world which was opposed to, a whole world opposed to it. Well, we have friends and allies. We don't object when they have nuclear weapons. India and Pakistan have nuclear weapons. Of course, whether ever anybody would use these nuclear weapons, except terrorists if they got hold of them, is doubtful. Because you use a nuclear weapon and you have a nuclear weapon on a retaliation. And this is why it may well be that this whole thing blows over when Saddam, faced now with very serious threats, may just actually a yield on this whole question and open up the whole of Iraq to inspection and satisfy everybody that he doesn't have, rather than suffer his loss of power. But that's a long way to answer a very good question. Yes.
You just said, or recently in your answer to the original question, that Saddam had already offered to open up the whole of his country.
I didn't quite get that.
I said you, not in answering the question, but in your original presentation, you had said that Saddam had offered to open up all of his country, and then you just said now that if Saddam offered to open up the whole of his country, that he might avoid some of the military action. Could you just explain that discrepancy?
Well, I meant when, if and when. We don't know. Saddam, I don't trust Saddam at all, and I'm prepared to believe that he is evil. Evil people usually want power. And if he's not a suicide bomber, you know. I don't think that he would like to be destroyed. I'm not sure he would like even to have to flee, which he could, of course, always do, and hide somewhere, like Osama. It seems to me he wants, therefore, faced with enormous superior power and the threat, if he doesn't allow the inspections fully to be carried on absolutely without hindrance, I'm pretty hopeful that the United Nations resolution will be very strong and effective, and that the inspectors will then have access to everything, including you perhaps have read that the diplomatic statements in the UN and elsewhere are that we will open up everything, all the presidential palaces, everywhere, anywhere the inspectors want to go, they will have unfettered access to everything. We have no intention, said the Iraqi representative in the UN, we have no intention of making weapons of mass destruction, chemical or biological or nuclear. You can come and see everything we have and so forth and so forth. So if that is maintained, of course, we don't know whether Saddam will keep his word on that. And I suppose that the president's policy is based on the theory that he won't. At least his language seems to suggest that he doesn't believe that he will. And I have no idea how do I know whether he will try to conceal weapons and whether he'll be discovered as trying to conceal weapons and whether some action will be taken. The only point I wanted to make in my talk as I thought more and more about this was that this is an obligation which he has to the United Nations, and the United Nations then is the sole of a party with competence, jurisdiction, if you like, with competence to enforce the obligation. and that diplomatic pressures should be, of course, exhausted before military action is presented as an alternative to the United Nations. So, you know, as I've thought more and more about this, I can imagine a situation in which a war against Iraq would be justified. But I think we're far from that at this point. And it may never be justified.
You just stated that all diplomatic outlets should be exhausted. What point do you think that those diplomatic, and what are the diplomatic efforts that you think should be exhausted, more so than what has already been done?
Well, I'm not sure I qualified to answer that question. I suppose diplomatic efforts means approaching all your, in the first place, your friends, your allies, getting them to approach your opponents. We've now taking diplomatic efforts in China to get the Chinese to deter the North Koreans from making nuclear weapons. That's an example of a diplomatic effort. There are ways of putting pressure. I don't see that Saddam is the person who wants to have his country destroyed. If he does, then maybe then there's no way of avoiding a war. But meanwhile, every effort should be made to make him understand that he's got to allow these inspections to proceed fully and fairly, and to convince the United Nations that he's not building up nuclear weapons. Yes?
My question is that weapons inspections were supposed to resume, I believe, next month under whatever pre-existing terms had already been arranged, and that then the U.S. stepped in and wanted these terms revised to say, and if it's not complied to in this certain manner, then we're allowed to attack. And that I read in the paper today that now the inspections that were to take place have been called off. And so my question is, isn't there some sort of process or hearing or something, some sort of resolution that has to take place in the UN before, you know, we can just call everything off like that? And, you know, if such hearings did take place, do you think that the current administration would, I guess, be willing to sit back and wait and see what develops, or do you think that's sort of lost?
Well, I haven't followed it perhaps closely enough. I understand that there is discussion and negotiation with respect to the terms of the inspection. My understanding, from reading reports in the press, is that the chief inspector is someone who we more or less trust, and he and the White House are negotiating what they think the terms of the inspection should be, and that the UN will ultimately determine the terms of the inspection. I really don't know enough about this to know how that ultimately is to be handled. But the notion that if the terms of the inspection adopted by the United Nations are not satisfactory to the United States, then the United States will then launch a war, which is somehow the impression you sometimes get from reading stories. I don't know how, you know, we don't have Colin Powell here. We don't have somebody who can tell us what's going on behind the scenes. Probably it's a good thing that we don't know what's going on behind the scenes. We know probably more than enough about what's going on behind the scenes. But if behind the scenes is a good place to negotiate. That's diplomacy. And I'm not sure about all the publicity. But anyway, to take what I thought was your point, that we may be prepared, if we don't like the terms of the inspection, to launch a military attack on Iraq, I think it's just simply, illegal, unlawful, in violation of fundamental principles intergovernmental and political and international and transnational and relations.
Thank you for speaking today. I appreciate you coming. I wonder if you could comment a little bit more on the United States as a world power and seeking to dominate other countries. Although I'm very opposed to this, these preemptive strikes, I have to admit the impulse that I have as a woman who's very glad to be living in this country, that a part of me says, well, you know, we do have some good government here. The United States is doing some good things. Our laws are pretty good. So maybe everybody else should be following them too. And I'm partly ashamed of that, but also, you know, just want to bring it up. So I wonder if you could just comment a little bit more on that. Our United States laws, should they be applied to the world? If you could comment.
It's a, you know, it's a very fundamental question. We want to, I'm with you, we want to share, on the one hand, we don't want to dominate the world, impose our views. On the other hand, we have a lot of good things which we wish a lot of other countries would have, and when they don't have it, we feel that that's a danger, that's a threat. That feeling went so far as to, you know, become a policy of so-called nation building, which, by the way, George Bush spoke dramatically against during the campaign, but was at some points carried to a point where we were insisting that other countries have democracy the way we have it. And by the way, these were usually our enemies, our friends like Saudi Arabia. We somehow didn't talk about democracy with them. But no, I think that the of course people say that wasn't the Afghanistan war wonderful? It liberated women in Afghanistan. But I also have this feeling, wouldn't the world be wonderful if it were like the United States, a federation of all the different countries with states' rights and then some central authority which would be sensitive to the diversities of the different countries, but they'd all come together, just as we have in the United States. We don't have civil war in the United States. We're a model. I think our federation is a model as we think about what a world order could be like. And then we have all these good things. Of course, we have all these bad things that go with the good things, like tremendous diversity of the split in income, the very rich and the very poor. Well, it's worse in some other countries, but it's better in a lot of other countries. We're not so great about that. I think ultimately, as I say, we have to be partner. We have a lot of more wealth. By the way, our wealth is a cause of enmity. I mean, billions of people in the world living at $2 a day. I think a billion at $1 a day, which is poverty. I mean, great poverty. And $2 a day, as I understand, in many countries, just enough to survive. Those poor people don't love rich people, usually. They don't say, aren't those rich people wonderful? They're so full of intelligence and industry, and we have corruption, and we have all kinds of trouble. Oh, we wish we were like those rich people. No, the 2 billion poor people in the world are saying to the United States, how about sharing some of your wealth with us? And we, of course, I think our policies in these respects, some of them are wonderful. We have very great feeling of conscience about this on the part of a lot of people. On the part of others, they take a different way of looking at it. And I'm for the first way of looking at it, to be partners and to share as much as possible, of course, with and so forth. And so, and little by little, to create a body of law which governs this, which is acceptable to us all, which preserves the best of what we have and eliminates the worst and helps the so forth. This is what we study in law school and hope to do. I see it being frustrated by this administration whose leadership, it seems to me from what I read everywhere, and I think of the people who came a long time ago, I'm told, in the Reagan administration, Cheney and others were advocating, in effect, world domination by the United States. And I think this is this concept of America's role in the world as being not only the superpower, but the righteous power, whose will be then imposed on others, either preferably through economic means, but if necessary through military. I think this is a dangerous worldview, and I think it's finding expression in the statements that are made. Though in the long run, in the end, I'm just, you know, if this whole thing blows over because Iraq actually does what it promises to do, can you imagine the next election, Bush will take full credit for having through force, and at that point he will say, you softies who said we shouldn't speak like that, would have allowed Saddam actually to keep on bluffing, and now I've talked tough to him and said, we'll break the law, sure, we'll bomb you, and we scared him, and finally, to save his skin, and therefore force, they will say, you see, is much more effective than diplomacy and law. And they'll be reelected.
Okay, I have a two-part question, I guess. The first one is like purely practical. You seem to take it as an assumption that the United Nations will never, I guess, sort of authorize another strike against Iraq. And if they do, in fact, there's some discussion in the Security Council as to who would be opposed to that motion, would that then give this coalition of nations a sufficient authorization to attack Iraq? Like in the first sense. And you don't have to answer them together, I guess. And the second one is, it seems to me that there's not necessarily like a moral assumption, I guess, like a moral imperative for the United States to participate in, or take as sort of a given that everything that the United Nations does towards the rule of law is necessarily the best way to do it. I mean, why should we abdicate our own best moral sense, given that there's a number of nations that participate in the UN that, for example, the United States was kicked off of the Human Rights Commission and was replaced by several nations that have zero regard for human rights. And in that sense, sort of why should we abdicate our good moral sense in creating a body of law that many nations who helped craft that law might not follow at all?
Mm-hmm. Well, those are two very good questions. I think the United Nations authorized the first war, the Gulf War against Iraq. If you have a veto power, it may be. See, I remember in the Korean War, you remember North Korea invaded South Korea in, what was it, 1949? North Korea was communist, South Korea was not, and this was Cold War, Russia-America, and East and West, if you like. And the United States went to the United Nations for authorization to resist, to defend South Korea against the North Korean attack militarily. And fortunately, the Soviet Union was boycotting the United Nations at that point, and so we didn't have a veto. I don't know how what the lineup was, I'm sorry to say, in 1991, 92, when the first Gulf War was launched and the United Nations supported it. I don't know what happens if you get a veto of now being threatened against certain proposed actions by the United States, by veto by Russia, France. Does France have a veto? I'm so ignorant about these things.
Yes.
What happens in that case, and what we really need, not me, but an expert in United Nations law to deal with this. But that really takes me to my second point, which is the law problem. When you're in a legal arrangement, a structure which is governed by law, the United Nations, with all its law, and in a world which is more and more being governed by law, we're hoping it will be governed by law, and legal means are taken to frustrate good things. You have to take a beating at that point. And then the question arises, you know, do you disrupt the legal order? Of course, if you do, then you may lose out in the end because the good things you're proposing may not have the legal support that you need for them. I don't think we've reached the point. I think it is true that our political leaders are now saying, oh, the United Nations is no good, we forget the United Nations, we'll act unilaterally. I think that's disastrous. But I think we should at least wait until the United Nations acts in a way which offends fundamental basic principles for which we stand. Then I don't know, then we have to deal diplomatically and politically with this problem. We're now in a situation where a very large number of nations are opposing the threats of war, which the White House president is making. You remember, at first they were being made without recourse to the United Nations at all. And people were asking, where's Colin Powell? And then he came in, and I suppose it was he, if I read the papers correctly, who induced his colleagues to go to the United Nations and to make it a United Nations affair. And so I think one can hope, at least, that the United Nations will resolve it. It seems hard for me to believe that if the United Nations Inspection Commission Committee comes back and says that Saddam is preparing nuclear weapons in violation of his obligation to the United Nations not to do that, that the United Nations would not act. Now, what I've said in my prepared remarks is that the first it must act diplomatically in every possible way. I suppose, secondly, it can act economically if economic sanctions work. They usually don't work at all. Hardly any economic sanctions have ever worked. Only when they're universal. Rhodesia is the one case I know of where economic sanctions work, where the whole the international community was enforcing the United Nations economic sanctions. I once gave a talk on this years ago to a very distinguished group of lawyers and diplomats and others, and I was on a panel, and I raised the question of whether anybody in the audience knew of any instance in which United States economic sanctions were effective in getting the government of the country against whom the sanctions were imposed to change its policy. And nobody in the whole row, really about 200 or 300 people, and there were, I was hoping, I was really curious. I had not found a case, and the only case they could come up with in those days was where the whole world imposed economic sanctions in effect on Rhodesia. Well, anyway, you have economic sanctions, and then you have, which express a lot of policy behind them, and military force at the end. But to start with military force, because we're frustrated in our effort to accomplish the good that we want to accomplish, because of the opposition of other countries which are behaving in a way which is bad, it seems to me is just wrong. I'm not a pacifist, and I'm not against the use of military force when you're attacked. I fought in World War II and was proud to do so. There, of course, we had the declaration of war against us by Germany and Japan. Someone declares war against you and starts destroying your vessels in Hawaii and so forth, and you fight. I'm for fighting back. But I would certainly, in all of, I notice there's a big generation gap in this matter of the Iraq business, that again and again the older people, ancient people like myself, especially George Kennan, who's even older, I think he's 92 or 3, was in the, these are people who they worry very much about a war which, like the Vietnam War, like some other war, will be both disastrous and immoral. Anyhow, this is my feeble reply to these good questions.
At that point, I'm going to have to step in. Professor Berman has another obligation at 1, but the room's still open if people want to continue discussing among ourselves. And first, I'd like to have some things. Professor Berman for having us. Well,
thank you very much. International program, International Law School Legal Studies Program committee meeting at 1 o'clock. But anyway, you're going to be better off without me up here.
Go ahead.
All right, but I want to full report on what is said after I leave, especially about me.
I guess at this point it's informal. I know for me, I've learned as much in law school talking to colleagues after we've had someone's speech as I've learned from others. From listening to people speaking. So no matter what, I hope you'll continue to discuss this. The Henry Student Lawyers Guild has talked with other professors who have various specialties and can comment with regards to the law and the looming war against Iraq, and you'll see postings about this too, and I hope you'll participate. And thanks for coming.